My name is Miss Gina, and the rumors were true. This house is lacking star power. Sorry, I'm late.
The brightest star this week is Gina.
I happen to make a wonderful
break.
For a
microphone was muted. Hello! Hello, everyone. My name is Miss Gina. Welcome along to the Miss Gina Show. Hello, everyone in the chat. We've got a few people waiting. Hi, thank you so much for waiting. So, it is another week, another Saturday. How are we all doing, first of all? I would like to ask you a question. How are you doing? I am doing okay. This has been a better week for me. Mental health-wise, I finally got my wage subsidy. So yay, I can finally pay rent. Thank you, New Zealand government, for taking a long time. Cheers to that. Anyway, if it's your first time joining me, well, I would like to say hi. My name is Miss Gina. I am a drag queen. I live here in Auckland, New Zealand. I am a musician, MC, hostess with the mostess, which are these two lovely things here. Yes. I was recently on a drag show called House of Drag. Oh, it's over that side, a little pop-up there, on TVNZ On Demand. It is a reality show where drag artists compete for $10,000. Go check that out. It's quite stunning. I'm also a showgirl at the legendary Kaluzi Bar and Cabaret on Auckland's K Road, Karangahape Road. Also, one of my legendary performances I just want to highlight, if anyone wants to check it out, is I did Jacinda in drag once. That's me right there. It's a little bit revealing, but I wore like this red coat, and it was just before the election, and I took sound bites of Jacinda throughout interviews, and basically just like did a bit of a political thing, but also made it sexy, because why not? Jacinda's hot. I can sexualize her. Fuck it. I'm a drag queen. I'm gonna do what I do. And there's already the first F-bomb. Kia ora. Let's have another sip of that. Yes, hello, everyone. All right, so we've got Vanessa. We've got Josh. Rhubarb Rouge. Kim, hi, Mom. My mummy's here. And we've got Luke in the chat. Thanks for being here, everyone. And, of course, producer Casey. So, today's episode, quite a big deal. I've got a dear, dear friend of mine, someone who I met, 11, 12, something like that. I'm 30 now. Yes, I'm fucking 30 years old. And I met JJ when I was 19. Just about to turn 19, I think. No, I just turned 19. Yeah. So 11 years ago, let's just say that. So if you have any questions for JJ or myself, feel free to leave them in the chat room right now. Producer Casey will compile them all together, and in the second half of the interview, we will answer your audience questions, which are very important. So be nice about it. Let's put some nice questions up there. Maybe a bit of tea. We can do that. We can delve deep. Now, let's move on to my first segment. Artist of the Week. Woohoo! So my artist of the week this week is this lovely lady here, Courtney Lowe. Now, Courtney is a musician and also a bar bitch at Kaluzi. Now, she does lives basically every Saturday around 6 p.m. She goes live and does covers of music. Now, as a musician, one of her main incomes was traveling, touring, and performing in bars. Obviously, she's no longer able to do that. So she's going live, asking for donations, and she does an amazing job. She's almost live for like an hour, 2 hours. This week she's taking a break, but next Saturday she will be live. Producer Casey is going to put the link in the chat right now where you can go and head over, like the page, and get ready for a live show. Now, she has told me that she is currently working on a cover of one of my songs. I'm not going to say which one, but I'm very excited. So she's going to be covering one of my songs next Saturday. So go check her out. That is on Facebook. Yay! Hello, everyone. We've got Jacobina in the chat. Julia, Vanessa, yes, everyone. Chad, hello, everybody. Thanks for being here. All right, now, let's move on to Gina's watch list. Now, my watch list this week was something that it's an iconic staple in New Zealand pop music history. She's probably going to hate me for doing this, but it is iconic. Let's go to Gina's watch list, and everybody, if you know it, sing along in the chat.
Oh, 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 do I hear ho, 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 kissing all year long under mistletoe.
All right, bad girl, Feeny,
show me
what
you got.
I've been a bad, bad girl.
I've been a bad, bad girl.
I've been a bad, bad girl.
Who knows this one?
I've been a bad, bad girl.
I've been a bad, bad boy.
I've been a bad, bad girl.
I've been a bad, bad boy.
Santa, don't get mad.
I can remember some of the lyrics.
I've read the truth. I've been really bad.
Wow. I think that's enough. That's enough. I mean, but also, so that would have been like 8 or 9 years ago, maybe. The Edge Morning Madhouse did a little competition with the three hosts. They had to come up with Christmas songs, and they took over the iTunes charts. It was iconic. Grammy, we've got iconic best song of all time. We got JJ was the most exciting pop star. Oh, well, that's a question for later. Christmas, legendary, iconic, Grammy winning. That's iconic. Outsold Mariah Carey. It probably did outsell, let's be real, back when it was released at Christmas time in the New Zealand iTunes charts, it probably did outsell, what's that one? All I Want for Christmas, that one. Yeah, it probably did. I just wanted to show that. It's so fun. Like, it reminds me of like when I released a Christmas song too under like Patty Boy. And sometimes music doesn't have to be so serious. It can be fun and entertaining. And cheers to that. Oh, who else is burning up in the chat? Oh. All right. Well, I think it's time. Who's ready? I hope she's available. I mean, I don't know what she's probably doing. She might be in the kitchen preparing some dinner or something. Apparently she's got a show that she does. Cooking in the kitchen or something, we never know. But yeah, I'll just check in and see if JJ Feeney is around. So, my special guest today is a woman who should not need an introduction, but for the kids these days who might not appreciate the icon that she is, here's a reminder. Radio personality for over 20 years, currently on More FM Drive Show, originally from the Edge Morning Madhouse. She danced her way into fourth place on season 6 of Dancing with the Stars and has appeared on iconic television shows like Celebrity Treasure Island. Author, actress, singer, it's my first drag mother. It's an in-joke. The original Scandal Queenie herself, JJ Feeney. Hey, girl.
Oh, sorry. Hello. Where did you come from?
I was just bored. I threw on a wig. I thought, let's just give someone a call and see if they're home. And you're home.
Here I am. I feel so underdressed next to you. I mean,
you
look at your makeup, your dress. I mean, flip.
You look good too.
Sorry.
Babe. You look amazing.
I put some nails on. That's about it.
I don't have. Okay, so that. Okay, a drag queen should always have nails, and at the moment I don't. So right now you're more of a drag queen than me.
Oh, I'm honored.
No, I made a little like reference there. Oh, we'll actually get into that a bit later. But how are you doing?
First of all, no, I have to say something. Okay. That music video was so embarrassing.
But like you're not really in it. It's just like images that got put together.
Yeah, I know. No, just the singing. Oh my god. It was auto-tuned to hell. Relatable. But anyway, sorry, back to you.
Yeah, how are you doing with isolation at the moment?
I'm actually one of the lucky ones because I get to leave the house and go to work every day. So I go to the studio every day about 12:30 and I'm there till 7. So it feels just normal to me. And in the weekends, I've got so much to catch up on because I haven't been home all week, basically, you know. So I'm lucky. I feel really lucky. Also, I don't mind staying at home by myself every now and then.
Well, it's annoying because you can't invite any, like, trade over and have a naughty little Tinder hookup while because you're not allowed to. You've got to, like, fuck.
Well, I couldn't do that anyway. I've got a boyfriend.
How could I forget that little toy boy? We need to get into that as well. Like, that's going to happen because, oh my god, can I just say, cougar goals.
It was accidental. I didn't mean for that to happen.
Yeah, I'm like,
you got to take it when you get it, girlfriend.
Oh, absolutely. I mean, yeah, as I said, I'm 30 now. Like, well, girl, I need a man. I need a man. Or a woman.
Oh, okay, wait. Can I ask you a question? If you're on a plane and, you know, you've got economy seats and you've been shoved up the back in 68K next to the toilet.
I've been shoved up the back many times.
And then the flight attendant says, I'm going to put you up the front in business class. But what would you do?
Of course I'd take it.
Yeah. That's why I'm dating the hot younger guy. Wouldn't normally have thought about it, but you can't pass up the opportunity, can you?
No, I've dated younger gentlemen in my time. And I always say, why adopt a cat when you could adopt a kitten?
I like it. What sort of man are you after? What do we have to look for here?
So, well, I mean, to get a bit serious, like anyone that is like willing to date someone like me, first of all, I mean, I'm a transgender woman, and so that comes with two carry-on bags.
What?
At the moment, I mean, they're down there. So, you know, it's kind of like... Anyway.
Do you like a guy that likes someone who looks like a girl but feels like a boy? Looks like a girl but feels like a boy.
I feel like a tomboy, I suppose.
No, the guy that wants you.
Oh, I suppose.
He wants someone who looks like a girl but feels like a boy.
It needs to be someone who, I mean, I've talked to straight boys on Tinder, but honestly, like the fully straight boys are just like, I can't do it. Like, they're a bit like, backwards.
I
want someone to like know who I am and be okay with that. Like my ideal person is someone who is bi because I can give them the best of both worlds. I got two titties and a dick, so you know that's bi. That appeals to bi people, right?
Oh my god, you're so lucky.
You want a dick?
I did not answer that question.
Oh my god.
No,
Are you a trans man? No, I'm kidding. Let's just move on.
What? No. I was going to say something rude. Yeah. Like, I wouldn't mind having access to one, but my mum's watching, so.
Oh, hey, JJ's mum. Your mum is so cute.
She is a little bit.
Iconic. Oh, the chat is popping off. Yes, everybody. Okay. I want to take it back a bit. So when we first met, it was for the Edge Next Top Friend competition. That was a time, like, for me, I'm from like small town and I came up to Auckland for that competition. It was like, oh, big city. And so basically it was like a Big Brother meets like the internet and radio kind of thing. I ended up coming third place. I did okay. I had a lot of friends.
But hang on. The idea was you lived in a house and you had with all these people and had to come up, you had to get the most followers on Facebook or something.
Yeah, it was a mixture of, it was like MySpace, Bebo, and Facebook. Yeah, remember those? Wow. Remember those? And so it was like you had like literally an hour a day you were allowed to go on the laptop and like promote yourself. But then we did all these challenges. Like we did like a Fear Factor challenge. We did all these dancey things. Like it was a lot. But I remember. Yeah. Okay.
I feel so bad about
JJ,
this.
There is a little something, so I'm just going to check if the chat's still going. Let's have a look. Health. Yes, excellent. Cool. So when I entered the house, and it was like one contestant at a time, it was live radio. Now, I'll just take it back. I was 19. I had been making YouTube videos, and they were very suggestive of who I was.
Yeah.
But I was not out about my sexuality. Publicly.
Right.
And walk into the house. Morning Madhouse are there. Live radio. Hello, welcome to the house. Contestant here, Patrick, how are you? Like, I was like, oh, hi, good, da da da. My mum was listening to the radio, everything.
Oh,
and the
God.
First thing you ask me, I swear it was the first thing, you were like, Patrick, so what do you think of the other gay guy in the house?
Oh God, I'm sorry.
And I was like, he's okay. But, you know, I mean, come on, it was obvious I was somewhat queer.
I know, that's what I thought. I assumed, which was terrible, but this is, we're going back a long time now, I've learned better manners, but I just assumed that you were gay. But it was so obvious to me that I thought that you, I just assumed you were out or that everyone knew you were gay or whatever. So I apologize deeply for outing you. But in hindsight, it was the best thing ever. Because now look at you.
Look at me now.
Blossomed.
My mum just commented in the chat.
I am so sorry.
Ha, ha. Yeah, okay, we get it.
Yes, see what I mean? Everyone knew.
It just took me a while. Someone in the chat, Jacobina said, JJ, a gay icon. She has an excellent gaydar.
Oh, I don't know if I do actually, because heaps of guys I have the hots for turn out to be gay, and I'm like, never mind.
Yeah.
Another unattainable goal.
Tell me about it. I'm surrounded by gay men, and now it's like, they don't want to date me now. Like, the struggle is.
It must be tough.
So, does Manu have a brother?
Oh, he does actually, but he's married and
matter.
You know,
I'm kidding,
they're very religious. Manu's the rebel of the family.
Ooh,
I think
we'll get into that. Okay,
plus he lives all the way in Algeria. That's not convenient, trust me, especially not now.
So I want to like sidetrack for a little bit just because my best friend is watching. Does the name Jacob Mills ring a bell?
Jacob Mills, is that Jacobina?
Yes.
Yes. Slightly, yes.
Okay, so they're my best friend now. One of them.
Yeah.
One of them.
Yeah.
We actually met because of you. So,
did ya?
Okay, so I'm just going to put a little tweet up right now, which is hidden. Go away. Okay, so people can see this little tweet. It is from 8:32 p.m. August 25th, 2009. It says,
oh my gosh.
At Patrick Cavill, at Jacob_Mills. You boys could enter together and get bald for Britney. Okay, so at the time, me and Jacobina didn't really have, like, many IRs, you could say. We were very, like, drawn to, like, Twitter and, like, the online stuff. And we both listened to the radio, obviously. And we had no one. There was a competition to it's problematic these days, you could not get away with it, but like shave your head to see Britney live in Sydney. We had no one to do it with, and so you tweeted the both of us and were like, you guys should do it together. And we were like, I don't know who that person is. And then like fast forward like a couple of years, we flattered together, and now we're both trans, so like look at that.
How about that?
I mean,
that's amazing.
And we're like great friends, and we joke that you were our like original drag mum.
Oh, that's so cool. I gave birth to you. Oh, and I didn't get any stretch marks from it, which I'm so happy about.
Well done. Yes. Just a word for vagina.
Just by the way, if you hear any noise in the background, my brother is pouring himself a bourbon.
Oh, of course he's having a bourbon. He is so that type of boy.
Hey, Paul, do you like drag queens? Come over here, Paul. Come over
just
here.
Just my good angle.
You would. She'd be your type. Look, long blonde hair.
It's
beautiful eyelashes.
Blonde.
Look, yeah. Come on. Come on. Stop pouring. Stop pouring and come and have a look. He's so shy.
Paul, hi. Hi, Paul.
Oh,
hi.
How are you?
Yeah, yourself. I'm really good now.
Do you like Gina, your type?
Oh, Paul, come back.
He'll tell me later. Totally. I'll tell you later.
Watch this. I'm going to get a DM on Instagram from him now.
Well, I would approve of the relationship, although I've never known my brother to like anyone with a penis before
that. Unfortunately,
you never know.
As I said,
hey,
I come with baggage, but you never know. I could help him discover his bi fantasy.
Mm. We've all got open minds around here.
I've got an open hole.
Gina!
Oh, my God. The wine's getting to me. Cheers, sis.
Oh, cheers. Oh my God! So it is past 1 o'clock in lockdown. 1 o'clock
totally.
Is about 12.
It's 4:20 just gone, which means another thing in this house. But anyway, come on, referendum. So yeah, that happened, and then also our relationship evolved. The Edge Morning Madhouse was the first radio station to ever play one of my songs live. So do you remember which song?
Hang on, wait. What was it called? Disco or something. Disco dick? No, I can't remember.
Disco erection.
Oh, that's it. That was so funny, that song.
That was just, having a bit of fun, a silly song, and, the fact that Edge wanted to play it, I was like, gag. But also, so one of my best friends, her boyfriend at the time was in a band, I can't remember the name of the band now. Oh, Equinox. They were like a Hamilton rock band, I think. And he was so pissed off that my silly song got played on national radio and their bands did it. And I was like, that's just how you got to do it these days. You got to do anything for some publicity. Hey.
Exactly. You got to stand out. Have something different.
And then going forward a bit, I started working with you on radiocheck.co.nz.
Oh, I know. My website. I loved my website, and it did so well.
It was always up there with the views and stuff.
It won heaps of awards. It was just, so much work. It was a full-time job, and I just broke one day and couldn't do it anymore.
Yeah.
I had a lot going on. I was doing IVF at the time, and I was very emotional, and, I had my nephew come, and, there was just so much going on, and I just thought something has to give, and unfortunately... That's my website, which sucked. But it's okay. I mean, I still can connect with people on Facebook and everything.
I think that's
the
thing. Back then, it was having a website was the main priority, I guess. But these days, with social media, there's other ways.
Yeah.
And speaking of, I feel like you've been around. And you've gone through the stages of the transition from radio being what it was, then social media being another platform. Have you found it a bit difficult being on radio with the change and trying to stay relevant by using maybe social media, or how do you feel?
It's definitely challenging, and you have to embrace it, and you have to ride that wave, otherwise you get left behind. So I've just gone with it as best I can, but I can't keep up with everything. There's so many things. TikTok, for example, I've not joined yet because it's just another thing. And I just don't, I barely have time to, do anything on my Facebook and Instagram. So you've got to pick and choose what's probably going to be the best for you and your audience. Now that I've left the Edge, I don't have to be on things like TikTok because More FM's a bit more mature. So my audience is more on Instagram and Facebook, so that's good. you do have to roll with it. You have to embrace all the new technology.
Otherwise you go out of business style. Yeah, I agree. And I think you've always done that. You've always managed to mold into new things, and it's something I admire about you, Joel. Interesting. You were actually one of the first people I told I was trans. Do you remember that?
Yes, I do.
I was up in Auckland. I can't remember why, but it was just as I was about to start transitioning, and like we met up for like a drink, and I told you. And I guess that's like that vibe of like I feel like I look at you as like a little bit older sister.
No, that's totally fine. I feel this special connection with you too, like a that kind of bond where, because I know that I've shared a couple of those big firsts with you, and that you've been, I felt honoured that you are brave enough to open up to me. Although when you walked in a miniskirt, I did wonder. You know, you do scream all and these had, things first, Gina.
I had those like shitty hair extensions and a beanie on.
No, but I mean, I don't think I was too shocked, was I? I was more, I don't even know if I was surprised. I think it was just like, wow. Because it is, it's a huge thing, and not many people know someone who transitions, you know. There's not a lot of transgender people on the big scheme of things, so.
Yeah, well.
And I mean, I've still got loads of questions. Like, I don't understand, like, everything about it, but I'd like to understand everything about it. So I know.
It could be like a.
Okay, well, what's the difference? Okay, so you're transgender. Okay, this is one. So you're transgender. So you're transitioning to be a woman, but then you're drag queen as well. So what is the difference between being a woman but being a drag queen?
Okay, so there are multiple things there. So gender is one thing. So my gender is who I am and how I present myself daily by using female pronouns, using my name, which is legalized now. So that's who I am. Drag is what I do. So drag is an art form. Drag is an expression of, like, a hyper form of gender constructs, basically. So you can have a drag queen, you can have a drag king, you could have a gender fluid explorer. Gender is a construct at the end of the day. Gender is definitely something that has been created by, you know, capitalism, by going, girls wear pink, boys wear blue, you need to buy this toy for your boy, this toy for your girl. Whereas, like, I mean, if you go to any daycare or kindergarten, I'm sure the kids are playing with whatever they want to play with. And so, yeah, that's the difference there, is drag for me is my art form, it's my expression of doing music, wearing whatever I want to wear, but gender is who I am.
But man, it takes so long to put on makeup and stuff, doesn't it? I mean, how high maintenance is it being a girl?
Oh my God, yeah, like totally. Sometimes I'm like, why am I trans? Because like, this is a lot. Like,
like obviously when you're at home, you don't bother. But like, how often did you go out?
You should have seen me 3 hours ago. With no eyebrows. But, like,
on a day, you know, when we're not in lockdown, you probably leave the house at least, you know, once a day. So do you have to put all that makeup on every day?
Yeah, I guess so. And that's another thing where it's like the societal pressures of how a female should look. So there's kind of this new wave of umbrella terms that fall under things. So for instance, like LGBTQIA+ is like the main term, the umbrella term. And then under that, obviously, I fall under the T umbrella, which is transgender. Under that, you have a trans male or trans female. But then in between there, you can have different things. So non-binary, someone who doesn't wish to identify on the spectrum, like Sam Smith. And then on the sides of that, you've got something else. So I identify as trans feminine. What that means is I was born male, but I identify on the female side of the spectrum. But I belong in the middle somewhere because I feel like I don't need to have breast implants. I don't need to have surgery to be a woman because gender is something on the inside. It's my soul. So I am a female, but on the outside, why should I have to conform to what society says this is a female? And I'm sure you've sort of gone through that yourself. I mean, you're someone who like rocks that short hair, and I'm sure you get it all the time. Yeah. Like when you first wanted short hair, like, no, you're a girl, you need long hair. Like, it's like, why? Who's telling us to look
that way? It pisses me off So many people say, oh, you've got a haircut like a lesbian. Oh. And it's like, what? Is that meant to be an insult?
Yeah, exactly.
Like, it's so? Why does it matter?
Like, yeah, exactly. And I feel like that's the cool thing with drag is, like, it's challenging the norm. It's challenging what gender is. So you can express yourself in any way. Yeah.
Yeah.
So that's to answer your question. Wow.
Well, thanks. Oh my God. I can't wait till this isolation's over so we can get together with some cocktails.
Yes, it's been so long.
Minus the tails.
Yeah. Okay, sis. Work.
Joking.
All right. Well, let's move into my segment. It's probably my favorite. It is called Q&A, sis. All right, I got some questions.
I'm ready.
All right, I'm just trying so hard to find the little instrumental for the Scandal Queenie segment, but it's like there's nothing online anymore.
Oh.
What was it? How did it go? Wasn't there like a little camera click or?
I love the scandal. There was that one. Oh, no, and that was for ages, and then there was so scandal. No, what was it? Oh, I can't remember. Do you know what? I can't remember. Right. We changed it a few times, but if you'd asked me, I probably could have got it for you.
Yeah, I was like, because I wanted to like pop up the little like, dun, dun, dun.
I could have got it probably from Dom.
Yes. Anyway, this first question was kind of like the Scandal Queenie of it all. So let's hit it. Are there any celebrities that you have interviewed who have not been the nicest? Maybe they were rude, nasty, or not interactive. What's the tea?
Okay. Most celebrities are pretty cool, but they generally, they've got their media face on. You know, so they come in and they do their thing and they be, you know, some are pro and they'll be like exactly what you want them to be. And some, they're completely different to what you expect. But in terms of being rude or horrible, I've only really had a couple of incidences. One of them was when I interviewed the Backstreet Boys. We had interviewed the Backstreet Boys at Vector Arena, and we got Nick Carter. Ooh. And I was so excited because it's like, oh, my God, it's Nick Carter, right? Yeah, who didn't? But anyway, he seemed so uninterested, like, and he didn't want to be there, and he was just eating, you know, pineapple the whole time and just chewing and just, I don't know, there was this vibe about him. So anyway, I thought, okay, well, he's not into it, but whatever. Yeah. But anyway, I had my website at the time, Radio Chick, and I was writing a diary all the time, and I wrote in my diary about how I met Nick Carter, and it was such a disappointment. And then someone sent it to him, and then he wrote a big blog about me.
Oh my God. Did you have a beef with him?
Yes, it was like this beef, and he was trying to explain himself and say how tired he was and all this stuff. Anyway, so I'm not sure I'll ever interview him again, but it was awkward.
Well, that's changed everyone. He's no longer attractive. Bye.
Oh my God. And then there was Ellie Goulding. Now, Ellie Goulding, she came in to the studio, I think twice, and she was amazing, like just really cool, down to earth. Her and Dom were talking about running, and Dom gave her a book that she was interested in, and she was just so cool. But then the next time she came in, she was dating, No. It was when Ed Sheeran had just written that song.
Oh my God.
Don't. And it was about her cheating on him with, was it Niall Horan? Yeah. Anyway, so we asked her a question about it, and she flipped, and she was just like this for the interview, like wanting the interview cut, and just really closed up, and didn't want to answer any of her questions, and was just like really standoffish. So I think by that time, I can see from her perspective, by this time, she's had a couple of years with the media, and the media are just annoying. Yeah. Like, we ask the same questions. We want to know your personal life. And so by the time she got to us, she was probably just fed up with it all. And so I understand it from her point of view. Yeah. But we always try and keep things light. But if you're in a shitty mood about something, then
you think like her publicist would have been like, don't ask about this, like, beforehand. So I guess that's their fault.
Yeah, well, that too. And then finally, I'll give you another one, Taylor Swift.
Oh, no, watch out, because she'll come for us. She'll sue us. She'll delete my YouTube channel, so be careful.
No, so I have interviewed her a couple of times, and it's always on the phone, but she refuses to answer personal questions at all.
I think because she makes money off singing about that stuff, so, like, she wants to save it for songs, yeah. Right? That's a thing.
But I think that's so hypocritical.
Yeah.
Like, you're telling us these stories in your songs and you want us to buy your music, but you won't let us ask you any questions about it. That's just, yeah, it's hypocritical. So anyway, we did ask her a question about her being seen with Jake Gyllenhaal eating ice cream. And it wasn't a direct question, but it was one of those cheeky kind of ones like, so who were you eating ice cream with the other day or whatever it was? And she just goes, guys, are we going to talk about my music? She got real shitty. And then the someone else came on the phone and said, okay, guys, that's the end of the interview. Thanks very much.
Bye.
So,
next.
He can't even push it. But, I mean, Taylor Swift is very clever and creative, yeah. And she's a smart woman, obviously.
Very smart. Oh, my God. What about all that scandal recently with her coming out being like, well, here's the, there was all that other part of the interview, like the phone call with Kanye, and it like was like,
oh yeah,
and it was totally like, oh okay, maybe Kanye was a bit of a dick.
I know. Well, that whole you see it from both sides at different times, but I want to get the entire whole story of that. I think we're only getting what she's saying, what he's saying. They're both giving their sides of the evidence, which looks good for both of them. It's hard to know, really, isn't it?
Yeah, you just. Celebrities.
They just need to let it go, though, both of them.
Yeah, I think so. Just, like, maybe just put out a duet and then just get on with it. Like, that's,
yeah,
that's
that would be good.
All right, next question. Wow. We have all seen your relationship with the hunky Manu, who has now gone back to Algeria. Are you keeping in contact? And how is Algeria handling COVID-19? Have you heard much about that?
Yep. Well, I talk to him every day in the morning and at night because there's a 13-hour difference at the moment. So there it is, 5:38 in the morning at the moment. I did say to him, well, maybe we should, you know, call it off because I don't know if the borders are going to be open anytime in the next 2 to 3 years. And he didn't really like that idea. Ooh. So
he likes you.
What is this? Like him, it's so hard. But I don't know. I'll just roll with it for now. It's a very interesting relationship in that respect. Like, do you break up with someone just because you can't see them, but you love them, or yeah? Oh, I don't know. It's hard.
How did you meet?
On Facebook.
Did he slide into the DMs?
There was sliding into DMs.
Was sliding later on in the night. Yeah.
No, we joined chatted for a while. I thought at first he was just one of those scammy people.
Yeah.
He's not. But anyway.
And so how long have you been dating, like, in total?
2.5 years.
Wow. Nice. I'm so happy for you. Like, his trip here looked so cute. It was interesting.
So good.
It kind of reminded me of something that happened with me. So when I was 22nd birthday, actually, I went to Sydney for like a week just to meet up with like YouTubers, like friends that I was like on YouTube. And anyway, the first night I was there, there was this really cute guy. He was only 17 though. Whoops. And he was like chatting with me. He was like kind of pursuing me, and I was like, okay, this is interesting, because I've never thought of myself as being like attractive or like, you know, like on the scale of 1 to 10, like, I've always been like, oh, I'm in the lower. I don't know. I've just never thought good of myself. And I was like, why is this cute?
Were you Gina or Patrick?
I was 22. Yeah. And so, yeah, he was like talking to me for a while, like in the night. And then like, we ended up like snuggling that night. And then for the rest of the week in Sydney, he was like my tour guide. Like, he took me around everywhere, showed me all the sights, cause it was my first time going to Sydney. And it was just like a honeymoon. It was so cute. And then we talked every day for a couple of months, and then he ended up coming back to Auckland and stayed with me for a couple of months. And I did the same thing kind of like you did. So I showed him around all of New Zealand. Like, we went to like Wellington and all the little parts, and like, yeah, it was just like this really cute thing. We're friends, but we don't talk anymore. Like, we're not together anymore, obviously. But like, yeah, it was just like seeing that lived, like you lived through that was like, oh, I know what that's like. Like, bring, like showing someone your home country and like, it's really cute. But then the long distance thing, yeah, is like horrible.
It's just an impossible situation. It seems impossible because not only can I not go to Algeria or anywhere, I can't even meet him in Bali or whatever. I can't, the visa situation is so difficult as well. So even if the borders are open, getting a visa for him to come back here or for me to go to there is so hard. So it's a lot of things to consider. But at the moment, I just, I don't want to let him go because he's so cool. And we talk every day. Yeah, he's so cute. Yeah. And his mum talks to me. She doesn't speak English, but she's learned to say, hi, JJ. And they're in the same situation as us, locked down, and he's an essential worker, so goes to work, but everyone else is stuck inside.
Well, I'm so happy for you. Wish you all the best, and I hope something like, yeah, I hope things move quicker and you're able to see him again.
Same, because this bitch isn't getting any younger. So, I mean, he's got plenty of time on his hands, but not me. I mean, I'm already past my fertile years. Menopause is coming up.
Yeah. Well, it's interesting because, like, with being on hormones, like, so I went through, obviously, like, a male puberty. And then in my mid-20s, being on hormones, I went through, like, a female puberty. Obviously not the period side of things, but, like, in terms of like what my body was doing, so like fat distribution, the mood swings, like my god, it was like, oh. So I'm like, wait, does that mean I'll have a menopause at some stage? I don't fucking know.
Oh man, I don't know what it's like, but I hear it's not fun. It's so,
but it's worth it. So now that you've settled into More FM, how have you changed or improved as like a radio personality since being on The Edge?
When I was on The Edge, because I was there for so long, I felt like I was getting a little bit too old for it.
Right.
Demographic. You know, the target audience. Yeah, the target audience is generally a youth station under 35 years old, generally. So I felt like some of the things I wasn't really into anymore. And so I kind of felt like it was ready to move on to the next demographic. And so More FM is slightly older. It's up to say 40, I think it's 30 to 49 is probably the main target there.
So
I feel more comfortable. I feel more comfortable there, but then there's still a lot of me that my personality that is very much from The Edge. So they're trying to tame me a little bit, and I'm trying to find that balance.
You can't be tamed.
I keep saying that you can't cage a butterfly. I do struggle sometimes with letting go of that sort of naughty side of me to be more mature. I love it at More FM. I'm really happy there. I love working with Flinny. Like, he's the best guy. Like, if you knew him, anyone who knows him loves him. He's genuine. He's funny. He's caring. He's smart, he's also, you know, a real party boy when he wants to be, and he's a loving dad and husband, and he's just really good at his job as well. So we get on so good. Like, we don't judge each other. Like, you know, you get put with people in radio, and sometimes it doesn't, the chemistry's not quite right, but it works for us. So I'm the happiest I've been in a long time working there.
So good, I'm so happy. Because I still do Uber driving part-time as, like, my second income. Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
So I've done it for, like...
As Gina?
I'm not in drag.
okay.
But it's, like, it's quite good because it means, like, I'm self-employed and I can just go out and work when I want to, log on, log off. It's kind of like it'd be my second income after, like, hospo and drag, and that's all there. But I find, like, More FM's, like, a good channel to listen to because it's kind of that in between, like... being like fun but not too boring, like and so, like, yeah, it's like cool. I listen to the drive show when I'm Ubering. It's nice. It's good to hear your voice as well, and like it's a fun show, and like, yeah, Flinny seems really cool as well.
We put a lot of effort into just, we just want to have fun. Like, we don't want people to be bored. We don't want to preach at people. We just want to have fun. So we tell fun stories. We're very honest and open. Like, if anything happens in our life, you'll probably hear about it the next day.
Yeah.
But at the moment, nothing's happening in our life. But, you know, it's, yeah, it's cool. Thank you for saying that. That's really awesome. Because I was so scared. I was so scared to leave the edge. Because it was, I was so successful there, and I was afraid, like, what would I be without Dom, for example? What would it, you know, would I adapt to this new place? Would they like me? Would the listeners like me? And it took them, you know, I could feel that it took them a little while to get to know me and accept me. So
Kiwis are always like that. They're so, like, they don't want change. They're stuck in their ways. Like, get over it.
Change scares people a lot.
A lot of people consider you as a role model. I don't know who. No, I'm kidding. Do. Do you feel the need to be careful with your actions or words that you use online or radio?
Well, I never asked to be a role model, and I never ever thought about being a role model when I got into radio, but it comes with the territory. So I do consider what I say and do just in case it would look bad. But the thing is, I'm generally well behaved anyway. So I'm lucky that I don't have to try to. I'm also a naughty girl on the side. I'm lucky that if I can just be me and be myself, I'm not doing too much that's not right. But then people don't always agree with you, right? And this is what one thing I find really frustrating is if someone doesn't agree with you, they attack you. If you say something and someone else is like, oh, I don't believe that, then instead of having a healthy debate with you, they will instantly turn on you and say, oh, what the hell, your opinion is wrong. You're so wrong, even if you're not wrong. You're so wrong. I don't agree with you. Oh, I'm not following you anymore. Or whatever it is.
There's no kind of good communication in the middle. Yeah, I feel that.
Yeah, I find that really difficult. And a lot of people will say to me, you're supposed to be a role model. Why would you say something like that? But it's what I believe.
Yeah.
So why is it, who's that person to say that I'm not right or that I can't have that opinion? That's that one frustration with it all. It's just like, stop attacking people who you don't agree with. If we all had the same opinion, the world would be back in the dark ages and we would not have moved forward. Preach. Because no one's ideas would be challenged.
Preach, Scandal Queenie. Yes.
Sorry, you got me all passionate and fired up.
It's good, girl. It's good to have strong opinions, but also have the ability to listen to others, I feel is a really good quality, to be able to listen to what other people are saying and then having a conversation about things instead of just attacking. Ugh, trolls.
Yeah, I mean, you'd know it, you'd get it. Because you're transgender, you're different, and some people are afraid of difference, right?
I'd be afraid
and
of
they
too.
Don't understand and they don't understand you.
Yeah.
So they will attack you. But it's why would you do that just because they don't understand you? It just makes no sense to me at all.
Absolutely.
In fact, it infuriates me.
Let's get him, girl. Let's do the last question. So last year you accused a man of assaulting you in a taxi. He was found not guilty. What does this say about the hashtag MeToo movement here in New Zealand?
It says that we have a long way to go.
Yeah.
I think the perpetrator of a sexual assault goes to trial and is innocent until proven guilty. And from the statistics that the court gave me, they are low. So a lot of people get off, right? Whereas the victim is treated as if she's lying
until
proven otherwise.
Yeah.
So it's awful. It's awful for the victim. So the taxi driver was found not guilty, but it doesn't mean he didn't do it. It means they didn't have enough evidence to prove he did it. Because a jury isn't going to say, they have to believe 100% that he did it. But if there's slight doubt, the doubt is his version of events against mine, his word against mine. There's doubt because there's no one was there to see it. So,
and then it's also where's the evidence that it didn't happen? Why is that not treated as a thing as well? on the other side of it.
Exactly. Because I know, I mean, I had more evidence to prove that everything I said was correct and true. But and he had no evidence to prove otherwise. Yeah. But he just said it didn't happen, and that was the so the case. His defense was I lied, and so for the Me Too movement, it's not good. It's not good at all. The system needs to change. Women are still treated as well. This day and age, there's still a stigma that women are sexual objects for men. There's still that stigma. Men still treat women like they're there for their pleasure, I find. Even though the Me Too movement and everything has really helped improve a lot of men's behaviour, and a lot of men I know, like a lot of good men, they don't, you know, in the office when there's a lot of sexual innuendo and bum slapping, none of that happens anymore. It's amazing. So people are well better behaved, and they know how to treat women better. But when it comes to a situation where a man does woman, that it's almost like they have more rights. They get away with it so much more. Mm. And for a woman who has, why would a woman who has been assaulted lie and go to all that effort to say it happened to her when it didn't? Because why is she made to feel like the bad person?
Yeah, it's ridiculous.
It's very frustrating. But for me, I was quite angry at the end of it, and I had a lot to say, and I thought, right, I'm gonna say this and do this and, you know, write a letter to Andrew Little and all this stuff. And then after a couple of weeks, I just calmed down and I thought, I need to let it go and I need to move on, because I don't think I can change anything here.
So giving him or that situation more of your time, I suppose, like focus on... the things you can do, the people's minds you can change, the advocate you can be to other women out there who look up to you. So I think that's like the more important side of it now. With
all I can say is that, you know, when it happens, and it's happened to so many women, it's just, I'm sorry that it happened to you. And, you know, I wish you luck. Just follow the path you think you should follow if you want to go to court and all that stuff. It's a very messy situation. It's so hard. And it's almost worse than the event itself.
Yeah,
like, I'm more traumatized by going to court.
Yeah,
I went to court three times. The trial went ahead three times. I suffer serious anxiety from that. I'm scared every time I see a taxi go past my place. I get a fright, you know. And it's not, apart from the incident itself, that is almost lessened to me now. It's like, okay, that happened, whatever. But I'm scared of everything else afterwards. Yeah. Yeah, but anyway, it's real heavy conversation. So I'll just have another.
Anyway, yes, another sip.
Yeah, but yeah. Anyway,
well, thank you for chatting about that. appreciate
it. All right. I feel really awkward about talking about stuff like that. So you're the first person I've talked to for ages about it. Actually,
thank you for owning up with me. I really appreciate that. I sent these questions to you first and was like, is there anything you don't want to talk about? And so I'm thank you for wanting to talk about that, because I feel like that shows strength in you, and I feel like people are going to appreciate that. So thank you.
Yeah. Thanks. You rock.
I'm
alright. Okay, right. I feel like we need to end on something high, like a nude picture of me or something. Here we go. Here's one.
Oh my god. Well, this was going to be show and tell section, so let's move into that. Show and pieces. So this is the show and tell.
This is my book that I put out 4 years ago. Or 3 years ago, but so you can only buy it online now. Unfortunately, I had a mental breakdown during the promotion of it.
Oh, sorry for hearing that.
There's some great photos in there. There's me nude again.
Oh my god, I remember that shoot. So good.
Dancing with the Stars. Oh, that was a life.
So is there still copy? Is it still available to buy online?
Yep, you can still buy it online under my married name.
Oh, Harvey. Yeah, interesting. Yeah, that was the time, wasn't it?
No, I still love Dom. Me and him are very close.
That's good. I met him a few times. Like, obviously not just at the Edge. Like, I met him at your home as well. And I feel like there's Radio Dom, and then there's, like, At Home Dom. And like I personally, my experience with him was very good. As a gay male at the time, I feel like people may have thought certain things, but I can definitely say that he was like treated me lovely. Yeah.
He is naughty, and he pushes the boundaries on the radio, but in real life, he's,
you know, yeah.
Yeah. he's just a shock jock. That's his job. In real life, he's such a pussy. And he would never, if he had hurt anyone, he'd be so upset about it.
I can see that. Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. I feel like he's someone who's able to show their emotions as well, like as a Kiwi bloke, which I think is quite good. Yeah. Now we're having another little section. Yep. Did you work out if you have a hidden talent or not?
I can't think of a hidden talent that I would have.
It's kind of hard, like, I swear. It's like, I don't, the only thing I can do that's like no one else I've ever met can do it is lick like the end of my elbow.
What? No, yeah. You can't.
Well, you try it first.
Okay. No, my brother reckons he can do it. Can you?
Show me. Are you good with your tongue?
Yes, he can! Come here, Paul. Come here, Paul. Paul, please. Come on, people don't need time to wait.
Yo.
Okay, let's do it. Show Gina.
Oh, that's not quite the end. Not quite the end.
Oh, not quite the end. It's like nearly there. Though.
Oh my god, maybe we're soulmates.
Yeah. Oh my god.
Yeah, weird, eh?
Wow.
It doesn't hurt. Like,
you're so flexible.
Yeah, I don't know why.
You're flexible, eh?
I'm not, though. I can't do the splits or I can't do high kicks or anything. It's just, maybe I've got like a little, like, yeah, I don't know.
Oh, yeah, maybe that's
it. I don't know. But it's just something.
No, but you need like, oh fuck, I don't know.
Oh my god, I totally smudged my lipstick.
Oh my god, girl. Oh, get rid of it.
Oh, this is so cool. Okay, well, I think it's time to move on to the audience questions. Who's ready in the chat? Because this is what everybody's been waiting for. Okay, thank you so much to, shout out to producer Casey. Can you believe I have a producer? This is like, I'm actually on a radio show.
Another.
Like, camp. Okay. JJ, who was the most exciting pop star you met from your time on The Edge?
Pink.
Of course. See, that's why people think you're a lesbian, because you like pink.
But it's just because she's fierce. What I love about her is she's so honest and she doesn't give a shit what people think about her. And that's what I love, because I hate people who bullshit just because they think that's what people want to hear. I just say it like it is.
I saw this really cool interview with her on Facebook. They were showing her fans that she's met over the years, and she remembers a lot of the fans she's ever met, like, and it's like that shows that she really does care about that interaction. Would you do drag, JJ? Oh my god, would you like do drag? Like, could I put you in drag? I've got purple wigs as well. Like,
I'd be a drag king or a drag queen. I'd be a drag king, right?
Well, it's up to you. Biological females can also do drag queen. It's just like a hyper extension of yourself.
I'll do it for fun with you one day, but it won't be my regular hobby.
No, just it's cool because like as soon as the wig goes on and you look in the mirror, it's like you become. It's like this confidence comes out of you. It's quite interesting. Yes. Okay. That's a challenge. I'm putting you in drag sometime.
All right.
From Gina being on YouTube to the kids being on TikTok, do you have any advice for kids growing up online in the public eye?
Oh, God.
Yeah, TikTok. Look, so many young kids on TikTok. It's very, like, concerning a little bit.
It worries me because, you know, I had my nephew in my care till he was just about 16. Mm. And so I've seen what the teenagers get up to and the kids. And... yeah. Okay. So you might have a kid who's very well behaved and good and safe and everything, but you can't control the stuff that's coming back at them.
That's the thing.
And and also kids don't have the maturity or the life experience to handle the criticism that comes through on social media and stuff. So I just feel like I personally think kids should not be allowed on social media until they're 16. And that's something that, it's an unpopular opinion.
I can see that.
I really do.
We
didn't have it, you know, all of us Gen Xers, we didn't have it when we were teenagers. I mean, so I there are ways, you can get through, you don't need it.
Like a Bebo or MySpace, probably around 14. But definitely in my older teens, like, for example, like you can't control what comes back to you. In saying that, like, me receiving a lot of hate on YouTube when I first started out, you know, people saying I should kill myself, they called me a faggot, et cetera, et cetera. Like, at the start, yes, it was hard. And for some people who live with depression, like myself, you can take it and it can really damage you. But in saying that, it took me a while, but after some time, I'm able to, like, I'm a stronger person because of it. So,
yeah. But you, like you say, after a while, and also you are quite active online, so you would be used to people saying that more than a teenager who's just with their friends, and then some bullies from school message them and say, you know, I just think it's just not, you can't, it's not a safe platform for teenage minds, or I think it's just not, it's scary. But I would say, honestly, the people that are saying these things to you, if they are not your friends or your family, what does it matter? Like, why the hell do you care what someone you don't know? Yeah, why would you care what someone you don't know thinks of you? Do you care? Do you want them to care what you think of them? No, just ignore it as well. Don't play into it. Don't go back to them. Just block them instantly.
Mute it.
Fuck you. You're not fucking you're not on my Instagram anymore. You don't deserve to be here.
No,
goodbye.
No, ma'am. You heard it, her.
Surround yourself with positivity. Yes. I block a few people nowadays because I just think, can't be bothered with your negative shit. Get off my page.
Next.
If you want to be negative about me, go on the Trade Me community boards where everyone's bitching.
Is that a thing? Is that a thing?
Yes, it is. Just don't come on my page and say all your mean shit.
Have you ever met or interviewed Madonna? That's us from Rhubarb Rouge, who's on season 2 of House of Drag as well. No?
Oh, hi, Rhubarb.
Amazing.
No, I haven't.
Oh, she's so camp.
Oh,
would you love to meet?
Yeah, I'd love to.
Madonna's one of those ones.
I would. She's in my top. But I've met Lady Gaga a few times, and she is...
She's
fabulous, friend. Like just absolutely 100% awesome, just like you'd imagine.
I don't think this was a genuine question, so I'm gonna skip that, but it said JJ versus Polly, who would win in a fight?
Oh god, Polly. She probably scratched my eyes out. Nah, I don't know, we work on the same station now, so we're friends. Yeah. We didn't used to be friends. We had a time of beef, I guess. Yeah, but you know, like, you move on with life, you grow up and you realize what's important, and honestly I don't even remember what it was about, so not even a big deal.
Gina, was it difficult coming to terms with realizing you were transgender? No, it was not difficult at all. Deciding to go down that path was like a back and forth, but for me, like, honestly, I just like went to bed one night and I was thinking about, am I trans? I've always been feminine. And then the next morning I woke up and I was like, I think I'm going to do that. So no, it wasn't difficult for me. Any gossip or tea about any well-known celebrities from New Zealand? Ooh.
What is tea?
Okay.
Oh no, I feel like an old lady.
Okay, so you need to watch Paris is Burning. It's about the New York Vogue scene in like the late 80s. I'm probably going to get this wrong. So the queers are going to be like, no, Gina. Okay. So, what's the quote? There's a quote. Anyway, so the tea is kind of like the truth. So it's kind of like, a little bit like, well, the tea is like purple is not her color or something, but we're shade, it can be like friendly nasty, so like so the tea's just the truth. Like, let's sip on the tea,
the DL basically. Like, what's the inside, let's say
what you really think about something. There's like a little fly. Go away.
I don't think I have any gossip on any celebrities that I can think of.
Okay.
I haven't seen any for ages in real life.
Yeah. Okay, I have something.
What? Oh my god. Be careful.
I don't give a shit. Okay.
Oh god.
It's kind of funny. So, I think it was season 2 of Married at First Sight. I think.
Yeah.
I forget his name. I would literally need to look at my DMs, but I can't remember. Okay, but...
Who was it? Slid into your DMs.
Okay.
Oh my god.
Okay,
I'm googling this. Wait.
Wait, oh. I knew you would love this. Okay.
Slutty DMs. A married at first sight contestant. Okay, and what was he saying?
Hang on.
Oh no, this is so scandalous. I don't even know if this is illegal. If this is legal.
Come on, whatever. Oh, okay, yeah, I remember his name now. Okay. So, someone messaged me and was just like, hey, I love your page. Like, I was like, I thought it was like a bot. So I was like, oh, thank you. And then they were just replying like, oh, like, how are you? And I was like, yeah, good. And then I looked at his profile and I was like, oh, he's not really my cup of tea, but like, if he's like a straight guy or like, I don't know. Like, it's like, it's nice when someone messages you, like when you're single, when you're me, but I was like, I don't really know this person, whatever. Anyway, I Googled his name, or maybe I scrolled down on his Instagram, and then I saw a photo of him with a wife, and I was like, oh, I know that girl. And then I realized it was like a photo of him and his wife from Married at First Sight. And, but like, his messages were suggestive. They definitely were like, you're pretty, okay, like, whatever. And I was like, oh. And then I realized, and then I was like, wait, is he still married to this person? Like, what is happening? Anyway, I kind of left it, like, I didn't reply anymore. But, and then, literally 2 weeks later, in whatever it was, Women's Day or Women's Weekly, they put up a tell-all story of her calling it off because he wasn't treating her nicely.
Oh my god, who was it?
Dan and Suki.
Gina! Whoa!
Yeah.
Oh my goodness. That's
tea. That's
really
tea.
Scandalous. Gina, that could make the news,
know,
what you,
like,
just said.
But like,
oh,
like, I could have pursued it and then gone to, like, you know what I mean? But like, I was like, I don't know. But like, at the same time, I was like, does he know I'm trans? Is he into trans women? I don't know. But like,
so, okay, so let's be clear. He didn't come out and ask you out or anything.
He slid into the DM.
He just was flirting.
Yeah.
Okay, so he was just sort of testing if you had, oh my goodness, that's wow.
But because at the time I was like, I don't know, but then a few weeks later, she was like, yeah, I called it off, like, we were long distance for a little while or something, and like, it didn't work out, and I was like, oh, maybe he's not a good guy. I don't know, because like, I quite like nice, and like, a lot of, like,
I thought they were like one of the success.
So did I.
They were one of the success
stories. But like, apparently they broke up like a few months back now. It was definitely like, yeah.
Okay. Wait, you are very attractive as Gina. Yeah. So I'm not saying that you weren't as Patrick, but anyway.
I wasn't. Let's
do
be
you
real.
Think does he did he did he think that you were,
well, I don't
a
know.
Woman, like,
that's,
you
yeah,
know.
Maybe I should have, like, well, it's definitely not gonna happen now. But yeah, I should have, like, I don't know.
He might not have known that you
but
were trans.
I don't know if he was like my type anyway, so I didn't really reply. But I replied a couple of times.
He doesn't.
Yeah. But I was like, that is scandal. Like, because at the time, I didn't know if he was still married or not.
Oh, I can't believe I've been involved in this.
Well,
you might get a few more views
absolutely.
Now, Gina.
Well, I mean, someone asked that question. I bet people thought the answer was going to come from you, but that's my tea.
Oh, my gosh. That is amazing gossip. That's amazing gossip.
I mean, oh my god, what about
my brother was outside smoking. He missed it.
What about Hayden? He's hot. Are you still friends with Hayden?
I'm not really friends with Hayden.
Was he interested
because
like, what was going on there?
Was he
interested
in
you? Like, what was going on there?
No, I swear to God, me and him were just really good friends. We had such good banter and we just enjoyed hanging out together, and we both knew we were just friends. Like, none of us ever made a move on each other, ever. But I can't really go into it, but we're not really friends anymore because he was going through a really hard time and said some things which upset me, and I just decided that I just didn't need the stress. So it's just one of those things where we both, you know, it just the relationship kind of fell apart, the friendship fell apart because things were said and, yeah. You know.
Well, it's good that you're able to be like I'm good with that now, but I never used to be. Like when there's someone who you're friends with or like in your circle and it's like a little bit toxic and you're kind of like, you're able to go, I don't need that in my life. Like that's, yeah, that's something that not a lot of people can do.
I am one of those people that I've learned a lot since being depressed like you, that you have to get rid of the people that are bringing you down, right? Even though it's hard. And this means family members.
Absolutely.
So
you can choose your family. That is a thing, you know.
Yeah. And with friendships, with Hayden, for me, he wasn't giving me, it's hard to say without, like, I don't want to talk behind his back, okay, but it just didn't work out. Like he was causing me a bit of stress and I realized I just couldn't deal with it anymore. So, but I swear that him and I were just platonic friends
but it
was nothing.
He could top me.
But he's also too muscly.
Yeah, he's a little bit, yeah.
See, for you, no, I'm not into muscly guys.
Am I, but like, sometimes you're like, oh well.
No, but I mean, okay, like, Manu, for example, he's very skinny. Like, I'm not even into really skinny guys. He's too skinny, but I feel like so insecure around anyone who's like muscly or has a toned body because I'm not toned. I've never been there. Frumpy. I've got chunky bits, and I think, why would I just feel really insecure, so I couldn't. It's hard for me to, Anyway, I don't know. Yeah. I can't. I think we've talked too much.
Yeah. Next, do you know any songs from Gina? ? Who put that there? And if so, what's your favourite song?
Oh God, yeah. I don't know this one. I'm terrible at song names. Like you were even singing my song before, and I can't even hardly remember it.
What are you both missing during lockdown?
Coffee from a takeaway shop.
I've got a machine.
I have got my Nespresso.
I've been making my own coffee. It's so good because I'm a barista as well.
Yeah. Oh yes, of course. You see, I've got an espresso, but it's not quite the same. There's something about the way the milk froths. It's not quite the same. And I miss like going to restaurants. I miss takeaway food. I miss going out to a bar with my friends.
I miss that.
I guess everyone misses those things.
I'm a very like hands-on person. Like I hug all of my friends, and I just really miss just like hugging someone. You know, touching. It's just that. Yeah.
I know. I haven't touched anyone, and I said to my brother because I was like, you know, really sore shoulders. And I was like, can you please give me just a little rub? Because, you know, I haven't been to the physio for a while. He's like, I'm not giving you a massage.
I can see that. Paul, feel free to give me a massage, though.
Hey, you should see his face right now.
My bubble.
Oh, that will be a whole new scandal if me and my brother got together.
So funny. Come on, Paul. Wait, how old is Paul?
31.
Oh, I've never.
So I would be your drag mum and your drag sister-in-law. Ooh. He's got two kids, so you'd have to.
I'm so plucky. I love kids.
A stepmom. When Paul said he's never been called an older man.
Well, yeah, I mean.
What?
Older than me.
Yeah, well, Gina's 30. No, but your girlfriends have been younger than you. What are you talking about?
Yeah, older men.
Oh, man.
Well, older men than me. But, anyway. Slide into my DMs later, doll. I promise I won't talk about it like I did with the maths person. Oh, that's so funny. Oh, people in the chat are loving everything we're talking about. Everyone's just going off.
Oh, it's got juicy all of a sudden. It's gone way over time. I think I'm not sure if anyone's still watching, are they? Oh, there's a few there, but
no,
we should wrap it up soon though, because no one's going to watch your replay if it's too long, unless you edit out all the stuff at the beginning that if I was
no,
boring, just get rid
no,
of all that
I
stuff.
Do it about, we Make should be summing up soon. That was the last question anyway from the chat, so that was perfect timing. Now, you've been doing a little online cooking show on your on your stories. What's the tea there?
Bitch in the kitchen. I just did it as a bit of a joke the other night, and then it just kind of got very popular. So I did another one and then another one. I've done five now and got my own Instagram page, Bitch in the Kitchen NZ. I don't know. It's just me being silly in the kitchen. Like, I'm not a very good cook. I'm just average. But, you know, you see all these real fancy pants people cooking online.
It looks
but,
great. Like, the only thing is I actually have been vegetarian for like a couple of months now, maybe almost 3 months. Which I never thought I'd do. Like, I've always, like, I mean, my dad was a butcher. I grew up with meat. Like, I love milk. I love drinking, like, milk and, like, you know, dairy milk and cheese. Oh, my God. But I found, like, I actually started to get a little bit chunky around the belly area, mainly because I was doing Ubering a lot and I was, like, not active. And also being a performer. So when I sing live on stage, I can't corset because I need to sing and breathe, but then like I didn't want to have a belly, so like it was mainly like I just wanted to like feel good and look good, and so I was like, I'm not gonna eat meat, and also meat is so bad for the environment, and so
it is.
You know, I just like I just was like no more, and so I cut out that, I cut out dairy, and I feel so good, but yeah, like during this lockdown I am craving a Big Mac. I don't care.
So you don't do dairy now?
No, I've don't.
Oh no! What? How on earth? I was gonna say like some of the things I cook.
Yeah.
Because I only eat chicken or fish. Mm. Like the spaghetti bolognese that my mum did the other night. That is actually a vegetarian recipe. She just put chicken in it.
Yeah.
So, but that spaghetti bolognese is really yummy.
Oh,
it's honestly a really sweet sauce. It's a sweet tomato. Mm. Oh, it's yum. But anyway.
Nice.
Anyway, my boss has been texting me today, I'm going to be honest, and he doesn't like Bitch in the Kitchen, what it's called. He wants me to change the name because he says you're not a bitch and he doesn't think everyone will understand that.
Yeah.
And so I don't want to change the name, but...
I did think that. I was like,
I don't know
JJ
what's
using a naughty word on public? Ooh.
But I thought it was ironic because I'm not a bitch.
I think,
but
yeah,
also,
people, and the pun,
people go,
like,
hey, bitches!
It's
more so, I don't know, I need to think about that because I also don't like to upset people and I don't want to upset my boss blah,
right.
But
see, that's,
we'll
that's,
see, we'll
I
see.
I work with drag queens, so literally anything goes.
I tried to say, like, I'm just having fun, but he says not everyone will, not, so this is the problem, not everyone gets your humour, so then they attack you, so if people don't agree with you or they don't get it, they'll just be like,
well, thank you so much for being here with me today, this was so good, I feel like we chatted a lot about certain things.
We should do this more often, like in private.
I'm
worried for you in that maths rumor, but
what's gonna happen?
Oh my god!
I mean, I am a TVNZ reality star now, so.
Oh yeah, I know.
House
oh
of
god!
Go
well, hopefully
you
can.
Yes. Do you have any like closing advice for people in lockdown who are trying to look after their mental health? Like, what are you doing?
Okay, well, like I said, I always try and get rid of people that bring me down now. So, but if you're in lockdown, that's a bit difficult. You might be stuck with them. Hang on 1 second. Oh, yeah, my brother and I have been walking some days.
Nice. Some days.
That's always good. You have to leave. You have to get out of the house. If you are in the actual... See, I get to go to work.
Mm.
If I wasn't going to work every day, I'd be going crazy.
Yeah.
So leave the house, go for a walk every day. Even if it's just around the block, 1 minute, 2 minutes, 5 minutes, whatever. And just try not to think about it as you're being locked in. Like, so if you think of it negatively, then you're going to be feeling trapped.
Mm.
But if you think of it as a, think of it positively, like, okay, this is a new experience. This is better for the world. It's going to be better for the world in the long run. It's just a short amount of time out of my life. I can learn to cook now. I can watch more TV. I can actually clean that linen cupboard I've been wanting to do for ages. I can, you know, sit in the
bed. Never been more tidy ever.
sit in the backyard and read those books I've been wanting to read. I can chat to my friends on video chat. Like, just think of the positive things, and it will make you feel better. If you think negatively and you think, oh my God, I'm stuck inside, when's this going to be over? Your brain is going to bring you down. Just be positive as much as possible.
I think that's good advice.
Yeah. Try.
Aww. Well, thank you, JJ Feeney, Scandal Queenie. I hope you're feeling good. I enjoyed that. And yeah, you're amazing. Like, when I moved to Auckland, you were someone who I gravitated towards, and I really felt like I belonged up here. So thank you for that.
Oh my gosh.
It's true. Like,
I had no idea. So thank you. Let's hang out more, because I miss you.
Okay. Thank you, everyone. I hope everyone in the chat enjoyed Miss JJ Feeney. All right. And
thank you.
Mute you. Bye. I'll chat with you shortly. We're just going to say goodbye to the audience. Alrighty, thank you so much everyone for joining. There are a few things that you can actually do tonight. There are many things happening on the Sosh Med, as we like to say. So tonight is Keeping Up with Kelly, California Drag Season 2. She is doing a live Q&A right now, I believe. It started from 5 p.m. So go over and check out California and say, Miss Gina sent me, because I want to support all of my drag sisters out there. Also tonight at 7:30 on Facebook, brought to you by Ending HIV, is Miss Wednesday Blaisel. Everybody Interesting is Gay. It's a live musical show. Blaisel is amazing. I love them so much. Go check that out. 7:30, Ending HIV. And then last of all tonight is Rhubarb Rouge, of course, from House of Drag. She is doing a live show from 9:30 tonight. So go check that out as well. Once again, thank you so much for everyone in the chat. I love you so much. It's been amazing. I look forward to these every Saturday. It gives me something to do. And I hope that you stay safe out there. Love you. Peace out.